Hello and welcome to this little island amid the ocean that YouTube is. On part 1 of the Cossack era, we started by learning who were the Cossacks and on what circumstances they were formed. We ended that first part with the knowledge that their position was rather uncertain, as much of their power shifted according to the political situation. In the early 17th century, the continuous involvement of the Commonwealth in a series of wars improved the Cossacks' position once again. As they became experienced fighters, they continuously participated in various fronts of battle. In 1604 and 1609, the Zaporizhians took part in the Polish intervention in Muscovy times of troubles. Hardly a meeting of the Polish parliament took place in the early 17th century without a Polish statesman producing a resolution or project that sought to utilize the military use of the Cossacks, while not giving in to their demands for an enlarged register and self-determination. Nonetheless, relying on their military capabilities would not take them far. Fortunately, perhaps at the right time and moment, they relied on a capable leader for the occasion. Petro Konashevich Sahidachny was an impoverished nobleman from Sambir who studied in the Austrian Academy and later joined the Zaporizhian siege. Realizing that the Cossacks did not yet amount enough power to match the Commonwealth, he invested in a conciliation with the Poles. To avoid conflict with the Poles, he agreed in 1619 to lower the register to 3,000, forbade unauthorized sea raids, and accepted the king's right to confirm Cossack officers. Yet, Sahidachny's most outstanding achievement was that he perceived the Cossacks in terms not only of their specific class interests, but also as a potential leading force in Ukrainian society as a whole. It was he who allied the rough, military, potent Cossacks with the politically weak Ukrainian religio-cultural elite. In 1620, Sahidachny enrolled himself and the entire Zaporizhian host in the Kievan Brotherhood. This step was meant to demonstrate that henceforth the Zaporizhians intended to uphold Ukrainian religious and cultural demands. Cossackdom had entered the mainstream of Ukrainian society. But after Sahidachny's death, the Cossacks were again thrown into conflict with the Poles. Dissatisfaction reigned among the non-registered Cossacks, which did not accept a serf status nor had hope on becoming registered. One of his successors, Doroshenko, attempted to redirect the Cossacks' animosity towards the Ottomans, involving the Cossacks in the factional strife of the Crimea by supporting an anti-Ottoman candidate for the position of Khan. This action would further hinder their relationship with the Poles. The king complained in parliament that domestic anarchy is again coming to the fore, creating difficulties for us and involving us in conflicts with our powerful neighbors, ignoring the obligations of servitude and the precepts of loyalty. They have established their own order, threatening the life and property of innocent people, and what is more, all Ukraine obeys them. Irritated by the Cossacks' idea of themselves as a state within their state, the government of Poland appointed Stanislaw Konik-Spolski as the one responsible for enforcing a hard line towards the Cossacks. After a set of confrontations between the Zaporizhian siege and a force of Poles led by Stanislaw Konik-Spolski, negotiations ensued with Doroshenko as hetman. The compromise was that the number of registered Cossacks would be raised to 6,000. They were divided into six regiments, based in Kiev, Kaniv, Korsun, Bila, Zerev, Pereslav and Cherkasy. Each regiment was then divided into companies, which were based in the smaller towns on regimental territory. Cossack officers had both civil and military authority over all the Cossacks in the area, while the headman and his staff, elected by the Cossacks but confirmed by the king, had overall command. Thus, despite close Polish supervision, the registered Cossacks perfected the self-administration. The Zaporizhian siege, in contrast, the bastion of the most militant and illegal Cossacks, although formally subject to the hetman, maintained de facto autonomy. The Poles hoped that their registered number of Cossacks would control the others, but as the Cossacks elected Taras Fedorych to hetman after executing the previous pro-Polish, Iristo Chorny, it was clear that the Cossacks still held much decisive power. Leading a force against the settled area, Stanislaw Konik-Spolski was once again called into action, but this time not as successful. In a treaty concluded at Pereslav in August 1630, the rebellious Cossacks won surprisingly liberal terms. The register was enlarged to 8,000, Triaslio went unpunished, and the rebels were granted amnesty. The nagging problem of the thousands of non-registered Cossacks that lay at the root of the rebellion remained unresolved, however. As the core issue remained unresolved, evolved, further conflicts arose, many times having registered Cossacks against non-registered, as the first hopes to gain favor with the Poles. The continuous rebellions led to the Polish crown to shift their position and take harder measures against the Cossacks. According to the regulations formulated by the parliament, the register was lowered to 6,000, and even the registered Cossacks lost their right of self-administration. The office of hetman was abolished and replaced by that of a Polish commissioner appointed by the king. Cossack colonels and adjutants were to be selected from among the szlachta. Strict limits were established on areas where Cossacks were allowed to settle, and anyone trying to make his way to the siege without permission was to receive the death sentence. The many thousands of Cossacks who were not included in the register were classified as serfs. In addition to these draconian measures, the magnates, especially Jeremy Wiśniowiecki, the Polonized grandnephew of the famous Bajda Wiśniewski and the largest landowner in Ukraine, instituted a reign of terror in the land, indiscriminately torturing and killing anyone even vaguely suspected of disobedience. Subtelny analyzes the reasons for these failed revolts. According to the author, to a great extent, the failure stemmed from the fact that many rebels were peasants, and thus the revolts had much of the weaknesses inherent to peasant revolts, as characteristically spontaneous. They lacked detailed planning and long-term goals. Besides their immediate requests, both the Cossacks and the peasants did not have a long-run objective or goal. Although endowed with a surfeit of bravery, the rebels were often limited and erratic in their military undertaking, because peasants were reluctant to fight beyond the bounds of their own localities or during the planting and harvesting seasons. Socioeconomic differences among the Cossacks added to the problem of inconsistency of action. The rank and the field, with little to lose, usually rushed into rebellion, while the well-established starishna generally opted for negotiation, compromise, or capitulation. But despite all, Subtelny highlights that the successive uprisings also reflected the growing strength and military sophistication of the rebels. As their numbers grew and tactics improved, so did the Cossack identification with the difficulties of the peasantry and the defense of orthodoxy. In the early 17th century, the focus of ecclesiastical and cultural activity shifted eastward in Ukraine. Galician Volhynia proximity to Poland exposed the Orthodox Ukrainians to a constant and debilitating pressure from their Catholic peers. As mentioned previously, with Ostrowski's death, for example, his granddaughter Anna gave the Austria Academy to Jesuits. Meanwhile, the Brotherhood of Lviv faltered as the Ukrainian burghers were increasingly discriminated against the Catholic Church and Polish government. Meanwhile, the booming eastern provinces were far removed from Catholic Polish pressure, and Kiev, which was steadily growing more populous and more wealthy, again emerged as a center of Ukrainian orthodoxy. According to Subtelny, the Kievan Cave Monastery became the catalyst for the Orthodox revival in the newly colonized land. A Galician nobleman, Elisei Pletnetsky, during the 1620s, assembled a group of learned churchmen, and after purchasing a printing press, launched an ambitious publishing program that within the span of 15 years produced about 30 books, mostly of a religious nature. This output was more than the combined total of all the other printing presses in Ukraine. In 1615, inspired by this example and financed from a bequest from Lelizaveta Hulevich, a wealthy Orthodox noblewoman, the noblemen, burghers, and clerics of Kiev organized a brotherhood associated with Bohyavinsky Church. A unique feature of this brotherhood was its close links with the Zaporizhians. Apparently, these contacts were first established through the intermediary of Josef Kortevi, the abbot of the monastery in Terekmiri, the site of the Cossacks' hospital, arsenal, and treasury. By 1610, these ties had become so strong that the Cossacks publicly announced, "We stand behind Orthodoxy and the clergy that has not betrayed our ancient faith." Under Sahidanich leadership, the Zaporizhians joined the Kiev Brotherhood in 1620, and more important, provided the support needed to consecrate a new Orthodox hierarchy. The consecration of a new Orthodox hierarchy was vital, as since the Union of Brest in 1596, the Orthodox had been leaderless. The ordinal of several bishops and the consecration of Yoboretsky as a metropolitan of Kiev by the Patriarch of Jerusalem was not well received by the Catholics and Greek Catholics, who viewed it as an illegal act. Nonetheless, the Polish government needed the Cossacks for wars, and thus did not intervene in the legitimacy of the new Orthodox hierarchy. The events of 1620 greatly exacerbated the Orthodox Greek-Catholic feud. In addition to differences over dogma and ecclesiastical procedures, the two competitors became embroiled in a bitter conflict over church properties. So violent were the quarrels over who owned the churches, monasteries, and lands attached to them, that hundreds of clerics on both sides died in confrontations that often took the form of pitched battles. Attempts were made by some Orthodox churchmen to negotiate and arrange a compromise, but several councils later, the attempts at a reconciliation ended only in failure. Distressed by the fratricidal struggle, several Orthodox churchmen, most notably the Archbishop of Polotsk, Miletis Morozki, and the rector of the Kiev Brotherhood School, Kasian Sakovich, attempted to arrange a compromise that would bring together one Rus with the other. Frustrated and disillusioned with the recalcitrant Orthodox compatriots, both Smotrotsky and Sakovich eventually went over to the Greek Catholics. Meanwhile, other Orthodox churchmen turned to the Tsar of Muscovy for aid. The situation would only change when in 1632 the Polish government took action and imposed a compromise. The Orthodox hierarchy was officially recognized and the disputed properties were divided between the two churches. The newly elected Metropolitan of Kiev, Petro Mohyla, taking advantage of the relative calm that ensued after 1632, Mohyla introduced badly needed reforms in the Orthodox Church and its cultural and educational institutions. By uniting a school he founded in the Kievan Cave Monastery with the Kiev Brotherhood School, Mohyla laid the foundation for the so-called Mohyla Collegium, which was destined to become one of the most important Orthodox educational institutions among the Slavs. The curriculum prepared by Mohyla schools combined Orthodox Slavic traditions with the traditions of the Latin Catholic West. In their enthusiasm for the cultural progress of the West, Mohyla and his circle sometimes failed to realize that although Latin philosophical tracts, histories of the world, or poetic work were appealing to a small, sophisticated group of scholastic, they did not have a broader appeal for Ukrainian society as a whole. What this curriculum failed to see was a cultural gap that gradually developed between the elitist Kiev scholars and the rest of the Ukrainian society. The publications made were mostly of religious essence, in which the use of Church Slavonic was still prominent in the literary language of Ukraine. Nonetheless, the simpler Ukrainian vernacular was gaining ground among the well-educated members of society. Pamba Berinda, for example, spent 30 years compiling his lexicon, which provided Ukrainian equivalents for Church Slavonic words. Another innovation in Ukrainian literature during this period was the growing popularity of poetry, especially panegyrics. As the schools produced hundreds of students and over 20 printing presses appeared in Ukraine, literacy became relatively widespread in the land. With religious issues and Western models stimulating the Kievan cultural elite, the culture of the masses reflected the impact of the agricultural lifestyle and the conditions of the frontier. They praised such simple virtues as hard work and honesty, while deriding immoral or selfish behavior. The epitome of folk creativity during the 16th and 17th centuries was the Duma or folk epic. Dumi were recited to the accompaniment of the bandura by wandering minstrels during market days or religious holidays, in Cossack encampments or religious squares. By and large, these lengthy versified tales concentrate on the two major conflicts confronting Ukrainian frontier society: the struggle with the Turks and Tartars and the resistance against the oppression of the Shlotsa. And as the Cossacks' importance grew, so did the vigor in Ukrainian religious and cultural life, with Kiev becoming again a major center of orthodoxy. For the city's religious cultural elite, much of which was associated with Mohyla Academy, it was, as Hyor Sivenchko put it, a time when spirits were uplifted and minds were expanding. While the resurgence of orthodoxy helped stem the tide of Polonization, it also infused Ukrainian culture with Western elements that would slow the Russification of later periods. Thus, after becoming perilously close to assimilation into dominant Polish culture and society, in the early modern period, Ukrainians produced more of the distinctive features that distinguished them from their neighbors. As the Polish government granted vast territories to the magnates in exchange for the protection of said lands, they also fed the growth of the Cossackdom. As both these phenomena mushroomed, the royal government lost control and did nothing to resolve the threatening contradictions that were evolving on the Ukrainian frontier. The colonization encouraged by the magnates allowed them to take advantage of the peasants as the time limits of the precondition expired. Their demands continuously increased, especially after the seemingly defeat of the Cossacks and peasants Ottoman rebels in 1638. As the magnates not only demanded but had a free pass to use violence, they many times resorted to the practice of arenda, aggravating the peasant's condition. The leaseholder agreed that anything he could squeeze out of the peasant above a set figure was his profit. Forbidden to own land but allowed to lease it, Jews often became leaseholders. Because they had to make good their investment in a relatively short period of 2 or 3 years, they exploited the properties and peasants merciless. It was not uncommon for a leaseholder to demand 6 or 7 days of labor from the peasants and with the help of the magnate's minions to drive them into the fields. The growing discontent was also found in other areas of society, such as in towns in Kiev and Bratislav provinces, which had a population proportionally 3 times bigger than anywhere else in the Commonwealth. Although many of them had status of towns and some were even under the Magdeburg law, most were not in truth more than forts. Their semi-agrarian nature and the fact they were on magnate-owned lands provided oligarchs with a pretext to question the position of the borders and demand onerous obligations and duties. Even the petty nobility, most of whom were still Orthodox, were liable to mistreatment and expropriation by the magnates. But as frustration and resentment mounted, the usual outlets that had helped alleviate them were being shut off. With the progress of colonization, it became more and more difficult for peasants to find empty lands to run away to, while after 1638, Cossackdom, which had traditionally attracted the most discontent elements, was severely repressed. Peasants found in other parts of the Commonwealth and Western Ukraine were not used to the status of serfdom, and although the Dnieper Basin was familiar to its burdens, it was also unwilling to accept it. Even with all the hardships faced, they still considered themselves as free men. Among the Cossacks, for example, it was an article of faith, if not of fact, that in 1582 King Batory had granted Cossacks privileges that made them almost equal to noblemen. For their part, the numerous townsmen argued that by definition they were self-governing and free, and after decades on a sloboda, it was difficult to convince a frontier peasant that he was not his own master. It was irrelevant how legally justifiable these perceptions were. The Great Uprising of 1648 became one of the most cataclysmic events in Ukrainian history, as the recently colonized eastern provinces of Kiev, Bratislav, and Chernihiv provided the stage for a revolt not only unique to the Commonwealth, but for all of Europe. These provinces had some of the most powerful and wealthy magnates. And yet, they also had a population that was not only willing, but capable to fight effectively for its interests. In newly colonized Ukraine, some of Europe's most exploitive feudal lords confronted some of its most defiant masses. While most mass uprisings in early modern Ukraine were characterized by a lack of organization and military expertise, the Ukrainian case would be different. The life on the dangerous frontier forced peasants and townsmen to become proficient in the use of firearms, and the Cossacks were a vehicle to the discontent felt with a well-organized core and a fighting experienced men. Thus, as the magnates intensified their exploitation, Ukrainian frontier society increased its willingness and ability to withstand it. Only a spark was needed to set off a vast conflagration. As we approach the Great Revolt, we end part 2 of the Era of Cossacks. In part 3, we will look into the person considered as Ukraine's greatest military and political leader, as well as dwell into the Great Revolt. Thank you so much for watching. If you found the information useful and learned something new, don't forget to like the video. And let me know in the comments if you have any information or source to add, or simply feel free to suggest topics for my next videos. If you are curious about part 3, then do subscribe and click the notification bell to immediately get notified once it gets uploaded. So, see ya, stay safe.